15 years, I think 7-8 years was not so good for the markets, for the business. We face challenge in actually managing client, remaining focused in investments. But over a period of time, we could slowly build the business. In a brick by brick, we could reach here. So it was difficult to manage clients in this period, especially last 6 years, where everybody lost faith in equities. It was difficult to handhold the clients and remain focused in SIPs.
As I said, Vinod is one of the runs one of the largest SIP books in the advisory IFA space. Vinod, can you take us? Any learnings for us from your, how did you build this business?
So
what was your conviction?
What I will share with you, how did the idea of SIP business came to us. I used to work with BSDL, and BSDL was second largest distributor in 1999-2000. I moved out of BSDL and started my own business. When we started the business, we kept on thinking, what is a win-win-win model? So when I look at SIP is a win-win-win model. If I bring SIP, the clients end up making money over long period of time. The asset manager actually gets the money to manage for long period of time, and we also get money to under our assets for long period of time. So it is win-win-win, and if it is win-win-win, it is scalable. The idea came to us, we did a back of the envelope calculation. We thought that I am in Bombay, if I can get a family who invests 10,000 rupees a month, and if I get 100 families like this, my SIP book is 10 lakh rupees a month. And if I run the SIP of 10 lakh for 10 years, the asset under management will be 55 crores. And if you do a calculation of say 0.6-0.7% trail, at that time that used to be the trail, the revenue comes to 32 lakhs. And in 2001, to think that 32 lakhs was an exciting number. And that's how we started building. So when I actually completed 10 lakh SIP, I recruited another person, and both of us used to get 10 lakh SIP for that person. So over a period of time, we could actually take it to 42 people today. And today we run more than 3 crores, so we logically should have 4.2 crore SIP book, and that's what we are trying to strive. And the best thing is that the first person who started doing this today has 55 crore AUM.
Many of you, tell me that we want to expand our business, but we are very scared of or worried about getting advisors or co-advisors with us or building an advisory team under us, because we feel that they will come, they will learn, and then they will take away clients when they go out. In fact, Vinod, as you know, as he mentioned, he started off as an advisory team. In 2009, he had the live experience of more than 80% of his advisors moving out of his company in a very, very short span of time. And now, from that period to now, he has again built it back to about 45 advisors. So Vinod, what is your confidence on, what is your view on this advisory? How did you get these advisors? Are you comfortable exposing your customers to them? How did you handle that exodus?
As an organization, we believe that if we give away our clients to the advisor, if you globally look at the statistics, if the advisor leaves your setup, 80-85% of the clients will retain with you, because the client looks at the organization, not the advisor. That is a global statistics, and it is applicable to India, and we are the live example. So in 2006, 14 people, six, out of 16, 14 left within a period of 6 months, but we didn't lose more than 10% of our AUM. So 90% of the time stuck to us, and we could get the time to rebuild the whole organization. So it's an unfounded fear that if I actually hire the advisor, entrust him with my clients, he's going to take away my clients. I think it is unfounded fear. If we have that faith, the client will always remain with you, and we have experienced that over the last 15 years. And that faith has actually helped us to go from, say, one advisor to 42 advisors today.
How would you leverage technology, Vinod, to expand? Have you done that to expand your business, especially on the advisory side? Have you?
So in 2001, when we started doing SIP, in 2004-05, we had somewhere around 300-400 clients. And suddenly I started feeling that we were adding almost 30-40 clients every month. And that's where one of my friends who used to work with me in BSDL, we got him. He used to to work with ICICI Bank at that time, and who was into technology department. So he came in, and for doing SIP business in 2002, 2003, when there were checks, there were no ECS, it was very, very, very important to get somebody who can understand technology and actually can absorb that business. At one point of time, we were adding 12 clients every day in 2003 to 2008. Today also, we add almost 10 to 12 clients every day. So it was very, very important to leverage technology. So we started building our own systems for doing brokerage reconciliation, for doing SIP reconciliation, to ensure that no checks are bouncing. If checks are bouncing, we can actually collect the money regularly and ensure that the SIP continues. So we invested in 2004 in that system, and that has helped us to build the business and absorb the flow.
You were one of the few people who went overseas. Have you been able to sort of leverage some social media? What prompted you to go outside the country when people say India is the best destination, you know, the massive middle class is here? Why do you want to sort of unnecessarily diversify and get out of your zone of comfort and go outside?
So 2008 crisis, the first thing happened that US started cutting rates. The moment US started cutting rates, we could see that the capital is very cheap overseas, not in India. And we were actually at a higher rate in environment. So for last 3 years, 2010 to 2013, we were at 10-12% interest rate, and US was at 0%, or Europe was at 0%. And we thought that if the capital is available overseas, why not access the capital overseas? So we started building a platform where we can actually get the money from overseas in FII. And after this FPI regulation, we thought, why don't, you know, try and take the advantage of that FPI route. So we started building a base in Singapore. We started a fund in 2014 October, based out of Mauritius through FPI route. So we today have a fund, and the NAV is 11.40 rupees, $11.4 in 3 months. So and that is getting money now, and it is available to the global investor. And we got around three FII investors. So three first. Foreign investors. We have one is Moroccan, one is British, and one is from Thailand.
How did you get them? Did you use social media?
It's pure word of mouth. We never use social media. We use social media for communicating our views, but most of the time we actually use word of mouth. So most of the clients who have invested with us has been referred by somebody else.
A very emotional question, which I think I empathize with, like Gaurav said, but we have to deal with it, is that how do you deal with this direct option, and do you see this as a big threat to your business model?
So, like, so a lot of things have been talked about direct option for the last two and a half years. So how did we face the challenge? So in 2012, when the direct option came, we internally had a meeting and we decided if somebody wants to go direct, we'll not handle him. So that is the stand we took. And we thought that handling his own investment, as Gaurav said, that you need a need somebody to mentor you, somebody to take care of your life cycle. Similarly, in investment, it has a lot of emotional cost, handling paperwork, handling nuances of like your iPro touch. You know, a lot of people not understand where to go, how to, what is UIN, what is KYC. It's not easy. And majority of population, 99% of the population cannot handle this kind of nuances. So we thought that it is not a big threat to us. So we internally thought that it's unnecessarily unfounded fear. 99% of the people will not be interested in doing it. 1% will be interested. And we have to live with it that 1% would like to go direct. So we were absolutely fine with this. And now there is a real challenge. The difference is 1%. It may expand to 1.25% between the direct option and non-direct option. But if you look at logically, the person who goes through an advisor and the person who goes direct, the difference is 2.7 times. Return difference is 2.7 times. So if somebody is making 6%, 8% by going direct, will make 18 to 19% by going through the advisor. So difference is only 1%. I don't think so it is going to hurt anybody. I think it is unfounded.
Can you elaborate that, Vinod? What is this 18 and 8, for example?
So if I look at ICICI Focus Blue Chip, how many years it's completed?
Seven years,
and a compounded return of 21-22%. But if they go and actually check how many clients have earned that 21-22%, And we will be surprised that the actual return which is earned by a client will not even be 10 to 12%. So the difference of 10, 11% is because of the emotional behavior of the client. And what is this emotional behavior? In 2008 peak, we had 4 crore plus folios in equities. Today, the equity AUM has gone up by 50%, but the number of folios has come to 3 crores. So 1 crore folios has lost. So people have actually redeemed at the wrong time. And the advisor would have actually helped him to stay focused and remain invested in the investment. And the and you look at the return which has been earned in last 1 year is 100%. If I could have actually managed to hold someone in the investment, he could have earned 100%. So what is the cost of the 70 basis points or 1%? By adding that, you know, charging that 1%, I can add 100% to the client. And I think that will always be valued in this
in this
field.
In fact, I have a interesting anecdote there that I think you have ICICI top 100 fund has completed about 15 years. NAV is about 250 rupees. So we said, wow, this is a damn good compounded return of about 18%. So we went and checked how many investors are actually there. We collected about 65, 70 odd crores in 1998. I know because I was in the team at that time. From precisely 843 investors. Out of those 843 investors, only 142 investors remain in the scheme. Out of those 142 investors, I think 40 odd are employee folios. 3 are with me. My father's, mine, and my wife's, right? Because there was a folio pressure. So I'm sure if I do little more investigation, out of that 140, I will find maybe another more Raghav Iyengars in the scheme. So this is what we know, it's crystal clear. So I'm sure many of them came in and never participated in that 10 rupees to 250 rupees journey. In fact, I am scared to put an advertisement out saying 10 rupees has become 250 rupees because then that balance 75 investors who are there, they also will take out money. If they don't have an advisor. If they have come direct or something, my sense is they will take it out and they'll possibly miss the next 3, 5, 7, 10 year bull run, which may give them much, much better return. Vinod, last question for you. Can you, for with benefit of all your experience, this is a team of advisors across the country, any specific learning that you would like to communicate to this audience? Because you told me that, you know, we are in a complicated world, right? I have a focused blue chip fund, this has a strategy. I go to Vinod and I explain it to him. I think his life is very complicated because like Gaurav said before this presentation, ultimately the person is dealing with emotion. We are number crunching industry. My job as a manufacturer is to beat the index. I don't think 99% of investors know what index is. Whereas you are trying to convert my product into a goal. Any learnings around that? What is any one point that comes to your mind?
So that's what I keep telling my team also, simplify. Whatever you offer should be consistent. The client should see the same movie. You know, if you actually create a movie where you have too many things happening inside the movie, you actually lose focus on the movie and you don't like the movie. So keep a very simple movie for the client. It should have a continuity. The client should feel consistent. The client should feel that you are dependable. And the moment he feels dependable, I think he refers more clients to you. So I think there is one very simple concept in investment behavior. It's called download cognitive. So if you burden client with too many information, he will actually will not be able to decide in life what to do. So if you make it very simple for him, so like when we do SIPs only 4 or 5 funds. We don't get into too many things. Over a period of last 10 years, we must have advised 7-8 funds and our majority of AUM lies there. So we kept it simple and we have stayed away from fashions in the market like accrual fund or a wave which comes European funds, and we have remained focused. This is what we need to do. Over a period of time, this will happen, and we will see the power of compounding. And I think if you keep it simple, I think there's a big scope in terms of getting more referrals.
Thank you, Vinod.
Thank you
very much. One big advantage or disadvantage of being before lunch is that I at least get a chance to communicate with a lot of you. The disadvantage of us is that food is being ready, but I think Vinod, I hope you're joining us for lunch. I am sure many of the audience members would like to interact with you personally. So thank you very much, Vinod. Thank you. Do you have any questions, Prem? How does this work? Yeah, hello. There's one more participant. There are two of us. Sorry. 10 minutes. Sorry. I'm so sorry. I think Prem, I think you need to take a mic. My apologies. Yeah. Nitin? I can't see Nitin. I would like to take, audience please, my request is just 5 minutes, 10 minutes. We have a very, very interesting gentleman, especially who's come all the way from Pune. Nitin Sawant is possibly our youngest IFA late person who's just joined the industry. He runs a beautiful model. He operates out of a place called Vita. Nitin is a management graduate from a premier Pune university. He was working with a company called State Street Advisors, which is a very, very large global custodian. He had an opportunity to continue his career. Obviously, he would have been doing very well. But he chose to move to his hometown, please Nitin, and set up financial business there. So, Nitin, I admire your ability to move from a big city like Pune, where you studied, where you worked, and you moved to a place called Vita, which frankly, till Nitin and I met each other, we keep bumping into each other in conferences like this. I did not even know, I'm sorry, that there was a place called Vita in near Pune in Maharashtra. What prompted you to do this? What was your motivation?
Okay. Hello. Thanks for giving the opportunity to speak this conference, firstly. About my working in Vita, like a small place, it's how you look about the place. As earlier Gaurav Mashurwala said that you have work-life balance. When I work in the city, I realize there is no work-life balance. We are working for the families, we should live with family. So that is my first belief. I go my hometown where my father and mother live. So that's my first basic idea. About small city, it's up to you how you look that city.
I don't know how many of you are aware, but how many of you are able to charge your clients for services? Can you, somebody? Yeah, fair amount of people. But actually, no, you are the minority. Nitin works out of Vita and he is on a complete fee-based model.
Yes, yes.
That is very rare that our clients willing to pay 20,000 and 14,000. He charges a client roughly 19,999 to start and then I think
13,999. Yeah, 20,909 and the renewal fees are 13,909. That is approximately 14,000.
So how do you manage to get your customers to pay this? What value do they see?
Okay, so value is financial planning itself has a good process. You follow this process, definitely people will pay you. Give the value, like every financial planners use Finametrica test. Give time to client, get comprehensive financial planning details, and then definitely it's a value, up to value, how you value put time to client, yes.
But clients in a small location are willing to pay because, first of all, as financial products itself is difficult, yeah, and getting them to pay for it.
If you see, there are many big small towns in all over India, but there are many good insurance products are sell. But why not mutual fund? If you see, as compared to mutual fund to insurance product, there are many clients invest in the insurance industry. How much they get? 5 to 6%. If I invest in the mutual fund, that's a value you are putting. So that makes you should inform it what value you are giving. So definitely they are ready to pay. So show them what is the future if you work with me and then see the value.
You have some overseas clients. Now, I don't know how many of you will. I found it very, very superb that somebody sitting in Vita is able to have and service overseas clients. Do you use social media? How did you get them?
I learned from the industry like Network AP conference and from overseas how they work. So I use these practices in my hometown Vita. So it's not my house is Wi-Fi, my office is Wi-Fi. I use regularly updates on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook. So with these references, I receive the overseas client.
Nitin also does something which is very close to my heart. As you know, mutual funds are mandatorily required to spend 2 basis points out of their AUM every year to do investor education activities. Nitin runs something called a financial planning awareness program.
Yes.
How did you get, what sort of a response do you get? Why did you think of this?
It's like an investor's awareness, but first you should know what is a financial planning. So that's my motto to show. So I meet doctors association, there is a bar association is there, so builders association. So I regularly go there, I say what we are doing, how it helps you your financial life. So they invite us and we do this regular awareness program with them.
If I have to summarize and do one last question for the audience, what is your learnings in this since you took over and started your own business, and what is your long-term vision?
It's a long-term vision. I want to increase my business. Currently we have 4 to 5 advisors. I want to scale it up to 50 advisors in next 5 years. This is the first.
Would you get people in Vita?
Definitely. If you have a right thinking, definitely get the people. And it's not hard, but you have to try. In 6-7 years, I've seen many problems, but I know that it will work. It's up to you how you think. And about learning from industry, it's a big industry. Clients is assets for you. Use them. It's like assets. So not more focus on more client, focus on specific client, those who pay you and increase their wealth. That's it.
Super. Thank you, Nitin. Thank you for taking time off and coming and spending time with us. Prep, do you have, yeah. I think there are some questions from the audience.
Yeah,
audience members, just 5-10 minutes. I think this is useful for you. Lunch is not going to run away, right, Prep?
There are many sensitive questions here. I will ask you a less sensitive one.
You're not
what is the sharing of revenues with your 42 advisors?
We have we have two models. One is we have people who are on our roll. There we have a salary structure, and there is an incentive structure for the people who are on partner with us. We share 50-50 revenue, and we provide them infrastructure.
Okay. The second question is, how do you find it feasible to run offices overseas? At what volumes do they justify their existence?
Actually, I require only 50,000 rupees per month to take care of my house. So rest everything I invest in my business. So in 2008, I used to make some money in my business. I used to invest. So we went to Singapore. We spent a lot of money there. Singapore is a very expensive destination. Cost per person is more than 5.5 lakh. So we burnt almost 60 lakh cost every year for last 4 years to get that vehicle in place. But 60 lakhs is what we used to make in that time, and we burnt there.
So you're investing a lot. That's commendable.
Yes.
Great. Nice feedback for you, Raghav.
Yep.
So there is Prashad Deshpande. So he likes your IQ touch. He's recommending it. And Pankaj Kapadia has a question which I think other people should answer. Why don't other people offer IT solutions like yours? So,
it's a good question. So, they should use your forum and ask.
Yeah. And one last question for you. What... you have employees in different cities, right?
Yes.
You have some employees in
Kolhapur, yeah, and Pune. Kolhapur and Pune.
Yes. Yeah, so how do you manage them?
It's an approach. That's it. Means how to manage? We have a back office team in Vita.
Okay.
So there is only financial consultancy. I work with initially level. You have to crack off 10 to 15 clients and then realize what is the financial planning process, and they used to. What exactly we do in this process, data collection and the plan writing, plan presentation, there's action plan, there's a execution. That's a quarterly review, as Gaurav said. That's a great process I follow and give time to the client.
Great.
So,
okay, great. Thank you so much, Raghav,
for
helping this session.
Thank you, Cafe Mutual.
Big round of applause for Vinod.
I hope we've been able to make some time up. Like the last over batsman, I hope we've been able to make some time.
Thank you so much. Hey, Nitin, late, I haven't seen him. Okay.